high.
High.
In all the earth. We bless God. Amen. Again, for the ministry of music that set the atmosphere so that we might worship Him in spirit as well as in truth. Amen.
Amen.
Again, one thing was brought to my attention, I neglected, and I do apologize. There will be a homegoing service on this Tuesday for Frances Whitaker. She passed away while in Maryland, and she will be brought back here to be for a homegoing service. The visitation will start at 10:30, and then the homegoing service will start at 11 a.m. on this Tuesday. So I'm certainly that the family would love to see you to come out and celebrate a life well lived. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Praise God again for that. As we come now to preaching and teaching from God's holy word, again, I'll share this with you. This is my favorite holiday. It may not be a holiday for some of y'all, this is my favorite one. And the reason is, I don't know my father. I didn't know until I was 32 what his name was. That the person that I thought was my father was not my father. And I searched for some years unsuccessfully to find my father. I've given that up now and accepted that it is what it is. But that has been the driving force in my life with my children, not in competition with my wife or my other son's mother, but to be the most important person in their life, to make sure that they have what I did not have. And so I look forward to Father's Day, and I always tell them, well, I do nothing special. I just want to sit around with my kids and just look at them. But I do thank God for the other men that He put in my life, my grandfather and my uncles, older cousins, who made sure that I did not go lacking in the things that I need. I had an uncle who drove a little red Corvette. We lived in a little treasure park. And I knew I was in big trouble when I came home. And the little Corvette was parked in front of the house. That meant my mama had called him and told him he needed to stop by and have a little talk with me. And he used to meet me down the road, because when I would see the car, I would try to take off running the road. And I'd go turn around, he'd pop around the corner and be like, I knew you was going to be running. And so I do thank God for that. And I praise God for all the fathers, all the men that stood in the gap for those fathers who were not there to make sure that we all got what we needed. Amen?
Amen.
And so today, for those of you that have your Bibles and venture to turn with us, we ask that you return to the book of Joshua, the 24th chapter, the book of Joshua, the 24th chapter. And we're going to read verse 14 and 15. Originally just 15, but verses 14 and 15. For those of you that are able, if you don't mind standing for the reading of God's holy word, Joshua chapter 24, verses 14 and 15. And I will be reading from the King James Version of the Holy Text. There you will find these words written by Joshua himself. It says, now therefore, fear the Lord, and serve him in sincerity and in truth, and put away the gods which your fathers served on the other side of the flood, and in Egypt, and serve ye the Lord. And if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom you will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land ye dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. God's word for God's people. It is blessed and made out a blessing to us all. Eternal God, our Father, again, Lord, we just thank you. Thank you, Father God. We thank you for the gift of just being able to wake up this morning and see the dawning of a new day. We thank you, Father God, that you've allowed us to come here to your house of prayer just one more time. We thank you, Father God, for all your precious people that are here under the sound of my voice. And we thank you, Father God, for you just being in this place. And so, Father God, we pray now that you would just move amongst your people, Father God. Let us know, Father God, that we have been in your presence. And then, as always, Father God, your manservant, I pray that you would hide me behind the cross that only you might be seen.
I pray, Lord, that you would speak to my mind and speak through these lips of clay, that I might get your word. You have given it unto me. And then, as always, Father God, I ask for preaching power, the kind of power that makes preaching easy. And Lord, we ask all these things in your Son, Jesus Christ, and our Lord and Savior, his holy and his precious name. And let the church say, amen.
Amen.
For the moment that we have to share today, church, I want to speak a word that says it's time for the real fathers to stand up, be seen, and be heard. It's time for the real fathers to stand up, be seen, and be heard. I'll admit to you, before the message comes, that this message was inspired. I was working in the school system, and they had an after-school program for students that needed remedial help in English. Couldn't read well. And I got called down to the classroom because they were having a problem with one of the little boys. And when I walked in there, what immediately caught my attention was he had on a pair of Jordans. He had his little Levi's on, pulled down halfway across his butt. He had a fresh haircut with a little design in it. He had a gold chain on and an earring in his ear. The first thing I said to myself, he got a little gangster star kid. And he was fussing with the teacher because she had took his iPhone. And he wanted to go about 9. Now he in there for remedial reasons. But he got all of this. And the way he was just acting and talking, the first thing I said to myself is, where is his dad? That's all I could think about. Because the mama was in there talking about man. What? Like, this ain't no man. He need your dad to take him around the corner for about a good 5 minutes and straighten him out. And I thought about it. I just said, he need a man. That's gonna speak into his life and tell him what he ain't gonna do. As long as she keep calling him man, he gonna think that he can do whatever he wanna do.
Amen.
And I just thought about that young man, and I think about him often now, and I wonder where he is and what has happened to him. But we have so many other young boys that are in the same predicament. And I thought about that, and as I thought about that, I wondered to myself, how many of you have ever heard of the lyrical geniuses known as B-Rock and Diz? Yeah. Many of you may not have heard of them, but don't be shy, don't be ashamed. It has been said that the depth of their lyrical geniuses will not be discovered until long after they're gone. But they did leave us, church, with this groundbreaking song that they released in 1997. B-Rock and Diz released the song in 1997 entitled "That's Just My Baby Daddy." Some of you all have heard it before. nothing elaborate about it. It's a guy talking to a girl, and he want to know about that other guy, and he keeps singing, popping up. And she, instead of her saying he ain't nobody, she said, "That's just my baby daddy." And again, as a father of four, I thought to myself, every time I've heard that song, how awful it must be for your child's mother to refer to you as a nobody. He ain't nobody but just my baby's dad. Because when I think about it, church, it makes reminds me of the fact that, you know, just about anybody can be a dad. You see, because just about anybody can help make a baby. You see, but it takes a real man to stand up and handle his responsibility and be a father. And you see, when I talk about being a father, church, I'm not just talking about paying child support. I'm not just talking about buying some toys and buying some clothes. I'm not just talking about coming around every now and then. You see, because anybody can stop by every now and then. But what I'm talking about today is being a real father. Which means that you don't just come around and you're nowhere to be found, but you are there for your children. Which means that they know who you are. They can talk to you. They see you. And they can expect certain things from you. You see, because anybody can reach in their pocket and give a few dollars. But what a child really needs from a man is, what I'm talking about a real man is, a man that will sacrifice his time and of himself to make sure that his children know that I'm more than just a baby's dad. You see, because we can be honest in here today, listen, I don't care how much mama tries to do, I don't care how much mama tries to give them, there's just some stuff that mama was not created to do. And maybe it's, I mean, we all know that it's mama's baby and papa's maybe, but there's some things that God did not create a woman to do. God didn't create a woman to be able to make a baby by herself. And the reason is God didn't intend for her to raise a baby by herself. You see, but there are a whole lot of mothers out there that have been forced to be mama and dad. Why? Because instead of being there, instead of being around, and instead of being a father, a whole lot of us have been satisfied with just being a baby's dad. And again, all I'm saying is it's time for us men, and I'm going to mean especially us black men, to stop being satisfied with being called a baby's daddy. And it's time for us to stand up, be seen, and be heard. You see, because when we're not there, when we're not seen, and when we're not heard, our children are forced to look to the world, look to the internet, look to the TV for the love they should be getting from us. And when we're not there, when we're not seen, and when we're not heard, these women are forced to try to scratch and claw just to try to make it. You have women out here working 2 and 3 jobs, and instead of being home doing homework and reading and math, they're out there working, trying to do what a daddy should be doing. And that's why I've come with a message today for all the men, because again, it's time for us to reclaim our home and reclaim our kids, because the devil church is trying to take what God has given to us. And I don't know about anybody else, but I refuse to let the devil have his way with my kids in my home or in my marriage. But if you don't want the devil to have his way in your life and in your home, then you got to stand up, you got to be seen, you got to be heard, and you got to let the devil know that if you want to get to my kids, you got to first go through me. You can't bind up a strong man's house until you first bind up the strong man. And you gotta let the devil know that, look, I ain't no easy win. You ain't gonna just come in here and take these kids and do anything that you wanna do. And that's where we find Joshua in our text here today, church. Joshua, again, may not mean much to some of you all in here, but this was God's chosen man to lead his people into the promised land. And we know that he was God's chosen man because in the first chapter of the book of Joshua, God tells Joshua flat out, look, no man will be able to stand before thee all the days of your life, because just as I was with Moses, so shall I be with thee, and you shall have good success. Amen. But that was a long time ago, church. That was in the first chapter of the book of Joshua. Now we're in the 24th chapter of the book of Joshua. Now Joshua is an old man. Joshua knows that the road before him is shorter than the road behind him. And so Joshua is leading the children of Israel with some final instructions. And Joshua, church, is challenging them to stand up and to choose whom they're going to serve. And in order to make his point to them, Joshua is bringing to their remembrance all that the Lord had done for them. Joshua is reminding them of where God had brought them from. And in the spirit of Paul, Joshua is saying to them that when you add all of what God had done for you, that being a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable, is only your reasonable service. And again, my brothers, I don't know about any of you all, but when I look back over my life, and when I think about what the Lord has done for me, when I think about where God has brought me from, I don't think that it's unreasonable for me to give my life back to him in order to tell him thank you. Amen. Again, you ought to see it as just a reasonable part of your service in order to give God praise, in order to tell God thank you. Because yes, we may have come this far by faith, but I thank God that he's been with me all the way. So, church, as we picture Joshua in this text, we not only see Joshua instructing the people about what they ought to do. But Joshua is also making some statements about what he is going to do. Joshua is encouraging all of them that now is the time to stand up, now is the time to be seen, and now is the time to be heard. And so the first statement that Joshua makes that every father needs to make is a personal statement. That's what Joshua starts with. Joshua starts with a personal statement. When you go back and read the first portion of the text, Joshua starts the text by saying to the people first that they needed to make a choice. Then after Joshua tells them that they needed to make a choice, Joshua makes a sharp turn in the text. Joshua then said, but as for me. In other words, Joshua said, now this ain't about you no more. Let me tell you about me. I want to make a personal statement that let everybody know that I've already made up my mind about whom I'm going to serve. Joshua wanted them to know that, listen, I want you all to make the right decision. I want you all to choose the Lord, but I also want you to know that I've already made my choice. Again, Joshua saying, look, it don't matter what I have and what I don't have, where I got to go and where I can't go. If I live or if I die, I'm going to serve the Lord. And again, church, I believe a personal statement like that from a father will automatically set him apart in the eyes of God. You see, because when you make a personal statement about what you're going to do, you're also making a personal statement about what you ain't going to do. And every now and then, all of us got to make it clear, Father, that that was then and this is now. What you saying, Pastor? What I'm saying is every father in here ought to remember their BF date. I ain't talking about your best friend. I'm talking about before fatherhood. And when you think about the stuff you used to do before you became a father, you ought to tell somebody, that was then, but this is now.
Amen.
See, before I had not made a baby, I used to only think about myself. But now that I got a child, I got to think about them first.
Amen.
Before, I used to keep my money on my mind, and my mind on my money, but now my mind is stayed on Jesus. We got too many of these fathers out here still trying to live like they don't have no kids at home. Still out here trying to have fun. Still out here chasing childhood dreams. Still chasing women when they ought to be home, sitting down, taking care of these kids.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Trying to tell you, some of us in here know why we learned how to behave. We learned how to behave because we had a daddy that all he had to do was look at us. And we got the message. We knew when to shut our mouth because he didn't have to tell us to shut up. All he had to do was just lift his hands up and say, you got a problem? You got something to say? We need to have a talk? You wrong? But now, these kids say and do whatever they want to do. They ain't scared. There ain't nobody there to make them scared. Again, we need more men to say, you know what, I ain't got time to be hanging out with my friends. I ain't got time to be washing the car and doing all of this other. I got to take care of these kids because I got to make sure that the devil don't get this.
Amen.
I can't stop him from getting all of them, but I can make sure he don't get the one that I brought into work.
Amen.
Again, you see, because when God gives you life and gives it to you more abundantly, Father, you're supposed to take the abundance that God has given you and give it to your kids. God don't bless us as fathers so that we can live good. No, you make the sacrifice so that they can live good. That's why you need more fathers to tell some of you brothers, look, I don't know what you're going to do, but look, but as for me, I'm going home being my kids. Y'all can go on vacation, go off trip, don't do all that, but I got kids at home. So as for me, I'm going to invest my time in my kids. I'm telling you, a lot of these kids are raising themselves. But all they know is what they see on TV. And if you turn the TV on just a few minutes and you see what they're learning now, they ain't learning what they used to learn. Some of y'all grew up watching Father Knows Best and Andy Griffin and all those good wholesome shows. But you can let your kids watch now, you got to monitor. What do you kids watch? Now they got men kissing men, women kissing women. stuff going on TV now. You got a lot to do, Kenny Rocks. And that's when we get in the chat.
Oh, no.
You got to be careful. And that's when you got to let us know. Hey, look, that's for me. I ain't got all that. But secondly, after Joshua made a personal statement, he then, church, he makes a public statement. Because after Joshua had qualified his statement by saying, but as for me, he then quantified his statement by saying, and my house. You see, Joshua wanted everybody to know where he stood. But he also made a public statement about where everybody else in his house was going to stand. Then what Joshua was saying is, listen, y'all can go ahead and do what you want to do. Y'all can make any decision you want to make, but as the head of my household, as the one who paid the bills in my house, as the one that brought them in the world, and the one that will take them out of the world, I will make the decision for my children. And the decision that I'm making is they will serve the Lord. Again, Joshua understood what his children needed better than they understood. Why? Because Joshua had been through what they were about to go through. There are some fathers in here right now that you can testify that there are some decisions in life that a child ought not make for themselves. You got to let them know that, listen, I don't care what they teach you down at school, you ain't qualified to make that kind of life decision. And until you are, I'm going to make the decision for you. And one of the decisions that I already made is you will serve the Lord. Now, I ain't saying you're going to like it, but you're going to do it. We get caught up in this life too much. And every now and then, you need to be, as a father, you got to stand up. And you can't be scared. And you got to tell them, look, I don't care what everybody else is doing. Look, I don't want to hear about anybody else's kids. I don't want to care. I don't want to know nothing. I don't care about them, but I care about you. And because I care about you, there's some stuff you ain't going to do. Not up in my house. Now, I can't speak for your friends, mama and dad. They let them wear whatever they want to wear. Let them do whatever you want to do. But as long as you live in my house, oh, there's some stuff you ain't going to do. I'm going to make that decision for you. Because again, there's some decisions that are too important for a child to make. Because children do not understand and they cannot see that far down the road.
Amen.
A child can't see past Friday. But you're a grown man. You done been down that road. You know all the traps. You know all the pitfalls. You know everything that's waiting for them. And if you let them choose to go down the road of destruction, that's your fault, Daddy. That's why children need fathers. And they need fathers that'll stand up and tell them like some of us were told. Oh, I don't know what you're doing on Saturday, but I can tell you what you're doing on Sunday. Oh, you going to Sunday school. Oh, you going to church. You going to the Bible study. Nobody care what you like. You sleep up in here. You eat my food. You drink up my air conditioner. Or you going to church? I don't know where you think these blessings came from, but everybody gave me these blessings. God sent these blessings our way, and you will thank the Lord. Again, I ain't trying to get none of y'all in trouble, brothers. I'm just trying to tell you that sooner or later, you got to stand up, and you got to be seen, and you got to be heard. You can't just be there and let them do whatever they want to do. No, they don't bother you. No, you got to stand up and you got to be heard. One of the things that we got to start teaching these kids, listen, I ain't trying to get you in trouble. Listen, you got to learn to say time out. I ain't talking about the little crazy time out by getting in the corner. I'm talking about time out for playing games, time out for doing what you want to do, time out for living by your own rules. You got to let them know that time is up. And time ain't coming back in. Not even in this house. Again, because one of our primary jobs as a father is to make sure that our children get to know God. To make sure that they're raised in the fear and the admonition of the Lord. Not to do what they like. The problem is your kids look at you as a father and say, this is my best friend.
Thank you.
I need no better for you. I need to tell you what you like, to hang out with you. No, my job is to raise you.
Amen.
And part of raising you is doing some stuff that you might not like. But you might not like it now, but a whole lot of us, there's some stuff we didn't like growing up that we thank mama and daddy that they did it anyway.
Amen.
We didn't like it then. God knows about that. My grandma went to church all day. We left to go to church before the sun came up, and we came back, the sun was going down. Now, it don't take that much church to get somebody saved. I mean, we didn't even come home to eat on Sunday. We ate at church. And after you get done eating, you have enough service. Then after you get done that, you got to have some kind of meat, something like, good gracious. We must really be mad we got to go to church this time. But you know what? You thank God. Because something was being deposited in you that you didn't even know. And it came back to your remembrance later on in life. But now everything is about what they like. And everything will need to be quick, fast, and in a hurry. You know, there's a time and place for getting some church on your phone and all of that. But ain't nothing like coming to the Lord's house.
Amen.
Sitting down in his presence and giving God's praise. That's just what I believe. But last, the church, after Joshua had given this personal statement and this public statement, he then makes a powerful statement. And in order to understand the power behind Joshua's statement, church, you got to understand where God had brought him from. You got to understand what God had done for Joshua. You see, because unlike any of the other ones that were in the promised land, Joshua was the only one that knew what it was like to work for Pharaoh. Joshua knew what it was like to be a slave in a foreign land. Joshua knew, church, what it was like to want and to not have. But the good news is Joshua also knew what it was like to have the Lord on your side. Joshua could testify to them of what it was like knowing that the Lord was following you all the days of your life. And Joshua, church, he knew what it was like to have the power of God working it all together for your good. And so Joshua could share a testimony with them because he knew some stuff that they did not know. He had experienced some stuff that they had not experienced. So that's why Joshua could tell them that, listen, if you want to serve the gods that your father served before the flood, or serve the gods in Egypt, or serve the gods of the Amorites, then you go ahead. But I know who God is.
Yeah.
Joshua was saying, I know what God has done for me. I know where God has brought us from. And God has been too good for me not to give him praise. You see, Joshua knew that it was God's power that had brought them out of Egypt with a mighty hand. He knew that it was God's power that had parted the Red Sea. It was God's power that brought down the walls of Jericho. And it was God's power that had caused their enemies to stumble and fall. Joshua knew, church, that it was God's power that was keeping them then. It was God's power that was keeping them now. Again, I'm sure that there are some fathers in this here right now that when you think back over your life, you think about the times when you didn't have, when you think about the struggles that you went through as a young man, when you think about some of the struggles you and your wife went through when you first got started, some of y'all didn't have what you have now. But when you think back over your life, you can truly say that God has been good to you. Living a whole lot better than you used to live. Your kids had it a whole lot better than you had it. Well, there's some of you all in here that testify that your kids and grandkids going to school that you can only walk by. Some of your kids and grandkids living in neighborhoods that didn't even exist when you were a child. And if they did, they weren't open to you. Come on, God's been good to some of you in here. And that goodness that God has shown you is the kind of goodness God wants you to show your kids. You got to stand up and down and know that God was keeping you where you could not keep yourself. A whole lot of you all went to college not because mom and daddy had some money, but because some folks in the church said, we're going to save up some nickels and dimes and quarters. We're going to pay your way through. A whole lot of you all got, y'all didn't graduate magna cum laude, or y'all graduated Central Boy. That's how a lot of y'all got through. Come on now, some of us are living real good now. And that's all a testimony of the goodness, the grace, and the everlasting mercy of our God. Amen. And when God has been that good to you, the most powerful thing you can do is share that testimony with your kids. And you say to your kids, look, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. We're going to thank God for every blessing that ever came our way. We're going to make sure that you know that I didn't do this all by myself. We didn't get this because I didn't make any mistakes. We didn't get this because I did it all right. No, we got this because I was the recipient of God's blessing. Amen. The most powerful thing that a father can do is to make sure the children know where their blessings come from. Thank God for our earthly fathers. Yeah, celebrate your earthly father. Put your arms around him. Tell him, Daddy, I love you. Thank you for everything you did for me, Daddy. But don't ever forget where Daddy's blessings came from. Daddy's blessings came from our Father, which art in heaven. Let me tell you something that I learned a long time ago, Daddy's fathers. If you start serving them, your kids will start serving. If you start praising God, your kids will do like that, and they'll start praising God. If you get up and come to church, your kids will get up and come to church. Kids do what they see, not what they heard. And the best thing that we can do as fathers, the most powerful thing you can do, is set the example for your children to follow. Don't just do what I say. I want you to do what you see me do. You see me down on my knees praying, then you pray. You see me giving God praise, then you give God praise. You see me serving the Lord, you serve the Lord. And when they ask you, Daddy, why you love God so much, that's when you got an opportunity to tell them, listen, he's the one that went to that old rugged cross. He's the one that died for you. He's the one that went down into the borrowed grave for you. And he's the one that got up early that Sunday morning. And he did it just for you. Teach your kids who God is. Teach your kids what God has done for you. It's time for real fathers. Stand up, be seen, and be heard. Let us bless the Lord in this day.